Living with Valor is where we have intimate conversations and storytellings with spiritual beings who want to share their human experience. But before we introduce our next guest, let me tell you a little bit about them. This person, an amazing person, a former colleague of mine, is a professional model and the owner of a sustainable fashion line. She spends a lot of her time advocating for body inclusivity and sustainable practices in the fashion industry. She is very passionate about her faith, people, and the planet, and she is excited to keep exploring the intersections of these three things in her career as a model. She's a small business owner and, more importantly, a purpose-driven human. Please, let's welcome our special guest, Chelsea Cheyenne. Hi, Chelsea! Thank you for coming on Living with Valor. Oh my God. I'm so glad you've made that time and that space for me. But before we start, I want to say happy birthday, Chelsea. You look fabulous. You went to spend your day on the show. You got any plans?
Honestly, it's a busy season with modeling. I had a show yesterday. I have another show tomorrow, so probably just rest.
So you've been ramping? Are you like doing the walkway?
Yes.
You gotta invite me to some of your shows.
I want to so bad. I'm so bad at like coordinating that stuff.
Yeah.
I'm just like, all right, Chelsea, just make sure you're like fitting on time and then doing the business and then working. Well, you know, just a lot of juggling, but I'm gonna get better at it. I got my planner.
Okay.
Because, yeah, like I was a planner gal, like 30-minute intervals before COVID. And then COVID hit, and I was like, well, nothing's happening, so I don't need it.
Oh, my God.
And then here we are a year and a half in, or kind of like, not post-COVID, but it's no longer a pandemic.
I guess not. I mean, I don't know. Did you ever get COVID?
Because I didn't.
I got it. I got it, and it's over, and I'm never getting it again.
Yeah, like, I never got it. I'm like that unicorn.
Right now.
Yeah.
Man, I'm loving the boots, the hair. Oh my God, you already just look, you know, exonerating fashion right now, setting trends. Yellow, it's just a fashion statement of supreme and confidence. Did you pick this on purpose?
This is like honestly my favorite sweater. I wear it all the time.
Yeah.
It's like a great yellow, and I think, you know, yellow on black skin is just more Italian. it's one of my favorite sweaters, and I think, you know, people always say, like, what color would you describe yourself as? I always kind of, I feel like I'm a yellow. And then the hair, this is from the show last night.
I
have time to take it out. So
it's a perfect time. So you're here hanging out with myself, Latias Muhammad, your host, and producer Pete. This is my producer. Say hi. He might ask you a couple of questions. You know, he's my, you know, my tag team, my boy, he's my guy. So before we get into all of the fashion, because, you know, we met at a former organization where we worked together in sustainability, and you started telling me about the fashion, and I was super intrigued. So, but before we get to that, why don't you tell us a little bit about who you are, where you come from, you have your siblings. Tell us a little bit about you. What's your story?
Yeah. All right. So, yeah, I grew up as a military child, so I moved around a lot. I'm a child of three, so I have an older brother and an older sister. My dad's in the military, so we moved around a lot. We're a very tight-knit family. So I think because of that, I'm used to traveling. I'm used to being a new person in the room, so I think that kind of helped build my personality. And I think in terms of the industry, networking, being able to, like, put myself out there and, just network with people, because networking, you know, I feel like the more I'm getting older, the more I'm realizing that it's not really about, like, I mean, what you know keeps you there, but it's really about who you know.
That is correct.
So, like, who you know gets you there, and what you know keeps you there.
Yeah.
So networking is, like, key, especially in the industry, and as a plus-size model representing that. So that's a little bit about me. I was born in Panama City, Florida. Stayed there for, like, 6 months just to, like, paint the picture where people are like, where are you from? I'm like, it's a story. So Panama City, Florida, I stayed there for, like, 6 months. My grandma was
Starbucks fan or just any kind of coffee?
Starbucks is trash. I'm sorry. I'm kind of a coffee snob, so.
Yeah, okay. So what kind of coffee do you like?
You just opened up a can of worms.
Hey, this is about your story. This is about your story, you know. So, yeah, what kind of coffee do you like?
Okay, yeah. So, there's with coffee, as you roast it, there's something called the first crack. Ooh. And then there's something called the second crack.
Okay.
Right, so the first crack is when you roast it and it literally has a little pop. And that's, like, called the light roast.
Okay.
And the second pop is where you get your medium dark roast.
Okay.
So, your dark roast. If you take it out immediately or close after that first pop, then it's a medium dark roast. And if you keep it in there longer, it's a dark roast. So I typically like that medium dark roast. So a little bit after that first or second crack.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I take it your coffee maker has full coffee beans.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You gotta show me about this first crack, second crack.
I honestly just learned about this myself. Like
coffee snobs.
I have a really distinct palate.
Yes.
Where I can like pick out, like if you put like one seed in something, I can taste it. Like,
okay.
So
is that the same thing with food?
Mm-hmm. Like food, ice cream, tea.
So you can taste all the spices. You're like, that's curry.
Yeah.
That basil.
Yeah, like, and people always, like, they're like, okay, Chelsea, calm down.
No, I like it.
When they go out to eat with me, and I ask, like, the chef or someone who's at the table, like, hey, like, does this have X, Y, and Z? And they're like, yeah, it does. They're like, how did you, and I'm like,
that's impressive. That is a talent. I mean, it's a talent, because I'd be like, something's not, but I could tell if there's a recipe if something's thrown off, and, like, even ordering products from a person and they changed it, oh, my God, that drives me insane. Especially when it comes to scents.
Yeah,
you know?
That was me with Shea Moisture. Because like, they ended up like changing the recipe, and I knew. I was like, something's wrong.
Yeah.
And she sold her business, and I was just like,
You lost a customer?
Yeah, literally. Now are you Chubby Curl shout out?
Oh! Chubby Curls! Shout out to you. I use your products. I love Chubby Curls. What do you know about Chubby Curls?
Well, I actually met the owner when I first moved out here.
Yeah,
so she's from Florida like I am.
Okay.
And she moved out here and she had the exact same thing of like, my hair is not dry. And nothing that I was using before is working now. And she just, the story behind it of like, trying on her hair, sending it to friends and other clients, you know, and coming with the final result, and it's phenomenal.
Wow.
Like, I will always be a Chubby Curl fan.
Yes, she is.
Small black-owned business.
Yes, black-owned.
It's a local Denver business.
Yes.
Support your local economy.
Yeah, and she's in Five Points a lot during the summer at Brother Jeff's Culture Corner Shop.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, so, small world. What I wanted to talk about is this modeling industry that you're in. How did you get here? And let's talk about some of the challenges of being an inclusive model, full-figured model, a beautiful, tremendous dark-skinned model. Oh, my God, I've seen your pictures, and I just wanted to die. I was like, Chelsea, you're so beautiful. Talk to me.
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you so much.
You're super photogenic. I was like, where are you hiding? And you know what? I'm going to start following you on your social media because I need to see you. Yeah, I'm just saying, those pictures were glorious. We're going to put them on the screen. Talk to me. Tell me about, how did you get into modeling?
Yeah, so it's actually, I joke about this with friends because it's kind of like a little weird. I was just walking in the mall with my mom when I was a teenager, and someone was scouting, and they were like, you have what it takes. And I was like, all right, I have what it takes, mom. That's how it kind of all started. It was a kind of like a school that prepped you for modeling, for acting, all the things. And at the time, I actually was more interested in the acting piece of it.
Okay.
So I wanted to act.
Right.
But it was very heavily modeling-centric because I think, you know, when I was a child, the triple threat came out where it's like, you need to be able to sing, you need to be able to act, you need to be able to model.
Right.
All the things. If you can't do all three, then, like, Disney, no one's picking you up. Like,
wow. Okay.
So they were trying to, like, groom that of, like, okay, let's give people the tools, how to do your hair, how to do your makeup. how to style yourself,
yeah.
how to show up on time,
mm-hmm.
what to look like, show up in for model calls and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, like that's how it all started. You know, the modeling, and you know this from your own experience, like
yeah.
the modeling industry 10 years ago was very different.
Oh God, yes.
So here I am in this school, you know, like with all these women who are white passing women,
mm-hmm.
And beautiful. But then you have me, who's like the opposite of all of them.
And you're beautiful.
And
because you used the wrong word, you said the opposite. But I know what you meant.
The opposite in terms of like skin tone,
yes.
body type,
yes.
things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
Yeah.
Clarity, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we would go to these castings together. You know, they're all getting selected.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't. And I was like... So then, but because I was so young, I started like having this question of like, am I beautiful? Like,
mm-hmm.
is there something wrong with me?
Mm-hmm.
And I think like when I started asking that question, I knew it was time to get out of it. Because I was just like, if I'm questioning this vessel that I'm moving through life in,
I love it.
You know, like,
mm-hmm.
This can destroy me, right?
Right?
So I was like, all right, Chelsea, you're starting to like question your worth. It's time to put this to bay.
Mm-hmm.
Fast forward in the future.
Yeah.
I am a believer. And I...
When you say believer...
Oh, yes. I am a Christian. So
okay. Yeah. Okay.
I am.
Okay. Yeah, we want to definitely, because you did mention about your faith. So, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then, again, we are talking about spiritual beings sharing their human experience. So, yes, I want you to expound on that.
Yeah, this is actually the first place that I've actually really
mm-hmm.
dove into that a little more.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I was just, oh, my God, when was this? I think it was 2020, which is funny, because, anyway,
mm-hmm.
hindsight. But yeah, 2020, the new year was in, and I was just praying. I was like, praying, like, okay, Lord, like, what does this
yeah.
next season look like? What does this next year look like? How can you use me, type thing?
Mm-hmm.
And he kind of was like poking on this wound that was modeling.
Oh.
You know, he was just like, I'm calling you back here.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've grown so much as a human. Like, I love who I am as a woman. I love my body. I love my hair. I love my skin tone.
Yes.
And I couldn't always say that,
mm-hmm.
right? So he's just like, I'm calling you back here.
Mm-hmm.
It's time for you to represent. It's time for you to be that emblem that you were looking for as a child,
mm-hmm.
Where no one looked like you. No one had your richness and skin tone.
Set the tone.
Yeah, it's like no one had your body type.
Mm-hmm.
It's time for you to represent for other little girls. So yeah, I was just like, all right, Lord. And for me, I was just like, modeling, is that really what you're calling me back into? I don't know. And I know that, you know, sometimes when you
yeah.
like, get that call, you're just like, that seems a little, I don't know. So I went through a place of like discerning, and I was just like, all right, I was like, God, I'll go to a casting,
mm-hmm.
and if it's not meant for me, let no door open for me. And when I say every door that shouldn't have opened for me opens, because
mm-hmm.
I wasn't taking it seriously. I was just like, I'm not sure this is what he's really calling me back
right.
into.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not quite sure I want to be back into this space.
Right.
Like, there's still healing that needs to happen here.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, like, doors that should not have opened up for me. And I was like, all right, this is real.
And that was the power of God.
It was the power of God. Cause like,
but that means it was your purpose.
Indeed, yes.
It was definitely your purpose.
Yeah.
And he put you back there.
Yeah.
Do you think there's more representation of us as dark-skinned women in the modeling industry?
Yes. I think the modeling industry is in the best place it's ever been,
mm-hmm.
historically, for sure. Is there still more work to be done? 100%.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think you'll see, like, definitely see, like, more, even, like, heights.
Yeah.
Like, you have, like, more skin tones,
mm-hmm.
ethnicities, because before it was just very, like, very Baltic, like,
yeah.
you know, like, that's just who it was.
Yeah.
You know, like, all the Schwabs
mm-hmm.
and, like, in the industry, which is awesome.
Yeah.
But, like, you can have, like, a lot of different skin tones. It was, everyone was very, like, Eurocentric.
Yeah.
Blonde hair,
blue eyes.
Blonde hair, yes.
So I'm just, like, fascinated with your hair right now. So the thing that has happened over the years is that, you know, being on set or someone in the entertainment business, it's hard to find someone who could do hair, makeup. So, I don't know if you're aware of the new SAG union. It is required that anyone on the set, that you have to have someone who can do all hair, or you cannot be hired. Have to have someone on the set who can do all makeup, or you cannot be hired. So, do you have any challenges?
Will will there be someone that can do my hair, or do we do it myself? Because, like, there's a different cost. And I am 100% on board with that. So if you don't have someone that can do my hair and makeup, then my cost is higher because I'm doing a service that you would otherwise provide for a fair-toned person.
Right.
So just period. But then showing up, like, oh, yeah, we got it. And then the person not knowing how to do their hair, clearly have them looking jacked up, makeup jacked up. And then they had to end up doing it themselves. And, yes, the campaign went great, but it's just, like, the equity of that.
Yeah.
It's, like, the time and resources that one, also the emotional training of that, the model having someone in their hair, having someone on their skin, like, messing it up. And they're being paid for this. And if they show up on that photo shoot looking like that, it says something about them.
Oh, well, let's talk about how the women put hairspray in their hair. Why are you putting hairspray in my hair? I am against hairspray in my hair.
Hairspray is just awful for anyone.
Right, but I'm like, why would you put hairspray? I mean, I came up makeup ready on one set. It was a commercial set. Hair ready, everything. So I went to see my hairstylist, some makeup artist, before the shoot. So all they had to do was put me in wardrobe.
Mm-hmm.
She's like, oh, let me just do some. She started, I was like, whoa.
You're like, I came ready for my touch.
It was bad. It can be traumatizing.
Yeah.
And again, when you say being the equity of not, like, why do I have to come in and do my own stuff? Why do you not have those things ready? It's very frustrating. So, have you had experience some discrimination? Do you have any experience of being discriminated or coming on a set and you were supposed to do one thing and they told you another thing? Or you went to go do a set and you got cut off?
Oh, 100%. Yeah, 100%. I think...
how did you deal with that?
For me, as a plus-size model, in the modeling industry, especially with runway, a lot of designers have stock sizes, which is size 2, size 4. Right?
What is it?
But for me, what's really frustrating is, you know, when I go to castings, I provide them with my comp card that has my measurements, my information on it. And obviously, granted, I've been told that, like, I don't appear, whatever that means, that I don't appear, like, plus size. They're like, oh,
no, you really don't. You look more, to me, curvy. But I don't know what plus size is, because for the entertainment business, I'm not skinny.
Yeah.
I'm a size 10.
Yeah.
But I'm bottom heavy.
Yeah, so I'm a size 14, 16.
Yeah.
You know, like, your girl's in there.
Yeah. But I don't even know, like, that plus size. Like, I don't know what plus size is.
Yeah, so, like, I guess, like, standard-wise, plus size starts at 12.
Okay.
Right? Anything above a 12 is plus size.
Okay.
I've showed up, like, gone to interviews and made it. And then they're like, okay, well, the fitting is on this day. So then I go, and then the designer is like, oh, I don't have anything that, like, fits you. And for me, I'm like,
hey, I'm your comp card.
Yeah, it's like, I have provided you my measurements multiple times. Provided you my comp card with my measurements.
Mm-hmm.
I provided, which also has my website on it, which also has my measurements. You know, so it's like, I provided you with everything. So, like, showing up and then hearing, like, oh, I don't have something for you.
Right.
When it's just like, you've had months to, like, prepare something for me.
Did they not look at the card, or they just think you look different?
Well, I just think that people are like, oh, everyone's going to be a standard.
No.
And
so what do you do?
You know, there's a space where you can't burn bridges, right? So you do have to move in some wise way, right? But I do, when I can use my voice, I do, right? So this actually just recently happened to me.
Oh, no.
You know? Or even, like, you know, I went to New York to, like, try New York Fashion Week, and I knew that, like, whenever there's a casting a week before a show, it's always going to be stock sizes, most of the time. Not always.
Okay.
But, you know, I still went. I still tried, because at the end of the day, it's like, if I don't walk, I'm still networking. I'm still putting my comp card in front of the right people in, a wider market.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I'm walking, and I didn't get selected. And every time I can, I always ask, you know, like, the model coordinators and stuff. And even the designers, like, you know, is there feedback? Do you have feedback for me? Because for me, I'm like, you get cocky, you get sloppy.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
So I know that I'm good at walking, but it's just like, what I always like to hear. And I asked them, I was like, oh, is there any feedback? And they're like, no, you have a great walk. We just don't have anything in your sizing.
Okay.
Right? But for me, when I hear model coordinators say that, mm-hmm. it's really discouraging. It's like, you have the power. Like, you literally...
Like, to say, we need to expound on this a little bit.
Yeah, and sometimes mm-hmm. the model coordinators are also the directors of the show. So that means mm-hmm. you're also saying yes to the designers who are coming into your show.
Mm-hmm.
And you can make a rule that, like, hey, any designer that's coming in, especially if you sell plus size
right.
on your website,
yeah.
have that with you.
Or at least have 50% plus size.
Yeah, I mean, because like there is like rationale behind stock sizing.
Mm-hmm.
People think it's because, oh, it looks better on like a smaller. That's all a lie. The reality is it's cheaper. The less fabric you use on a runway
mm-hmm.
to show the looks, you get to see like what makes it like what people like, what people don't like, and then
right.
when you make your actual collection for selling,
yeah.
you know what to nip and what not.
Yeah.
So like there is like strategy to it,
mm-hmm.
but for me, I'm like, if you're gonna end up selling people like me.
Yeah.
Then represent people like me
oh,
on the runway.
I agree. But I do believe that it is starting to increase, and
mm-hmm.
I see a lot of full-figure women on the runway now. And just in general, like, I go, my friend is, she's a fashion model. She's not very tall. She's 5'3", but she's curvy. She's very heavy, curvy. But that girl got mean walk. She is a great.
And even that's
yeah,
like,
she's got a mean walk, and she, I was like, girl. I mean, she's thick all the way down, and she
yeah.
looks amazing, so.
And that's a representation of, like, how the industry has become more inclusive, right?
Yeah.
Because for runway, if you were under 5'10", you weren't all, you didn't want happening. They would have been like, that's cute.
Yeah.
You know, so, like, it is more, and I've met people, like.
Do you think Eva Marcel wrote that mode, the height mode? Because she's only 5'4", 4'4", 5'5", I think.
You know, I'm not really sure.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think that, if I'm being honest, I think that the industry is realizing that if they don't cater to how the world is, how people look,
mm-hmm.
that they're not going to have a foot, because they're selling a fantasy.
Yeah.
Right? But if you're selling a fantasy that doesn't look like
me.
Yeah, look like the
right.
people that you're trying to sell a fantasy to.
Right.
Who's going by? They would be like, that's cute, next. And I would be like, 15! You know, like.
So what do you think is the boundaries, or do you see the boundaries, like, say, you want to be inclusive, but you also don't want to be a token. Do you see?
Exactly.
So how do you discern of, oh, they just got me to be a token? Because now we're on this equity, inclusion, diversity. It's really
mm-hmm.
big. It's really necessary, but what do you think, can you discern how if you're a token versus, you know, because you fit a lot of the criteria.
Yeah, 100%. You definitely, I think any person of color knows, you have that gut feeling that, like, you can't really, you know, you can't really, like, try to describe as someone who's not a person of color.
Yeah.
Where you're like, all right, I'm a token here. And, you know, does it suck? Yes. But at the end of the day, it's exposing me. At the end of the day, I'm getting pictures. At the end of the day, you know, I'm on this campaign.
Mm-hmm.
I'm, you know, I'm being this representation that other people are going to look at and say, wait a minute.
Yeah.
She exudes all the things high fashion exudes, but she's in a bigger body.
Yeah.
And it stretches people's minds. So does it suck to be a token? Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But will I be the token in the industry to help push open
the doors yeah.
to get rid of the beauty ideal and to open up beauty as a spectrum,
yeah.
so that, you know, someone that's fair skinned, someone that's dark skinned, someone that's skinny, someone that's not, someone that's, you know, has, you know, skin conditions, someone who doesn't,
yeah.
all can look at beauty as a spectrum and say, I fit in this and I'm beautiful.
Yes.
Versus when you have an ideal that's European centric,
mm-hmm.
I will never be any of the things on European centric. So, you know, so it's like, I'm already setting myself up for failure.
Right.
And we do, like, the things that our brains actually do of deduction.
Yeah.
Of, like, okay,
mm-hmm.
this is beauty.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm, all these things are, like, opposite.
Right.
You know, you start.
Yeah.
You,
yeah. And it can put you in a negative headspace, too.
Exactly.
Because first of all, I don't believe in comparing and contrasting myself, because we are all here imperfectly perfect,
100%.
Created by God.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, God didn't make no mistake. So we just have to fit, find our place in our space. And I love it, because when you know, I always look at, okay, I might be a token, but what can I do to make this situation an opportunity for me? and kind of, yes, and others, yes. Yeah. You know, so, you know, yeah, we don't want to be a token. Yeah, we want to be appreciated because, you know, we don't want to go into imposter disease and get back in that circle and everything. Mm-hmm. So I'm just fascinated. I want to just elaborate on something. Do you ever do public speaking or anything of that nature? Because you have a good spirit that would be so, like, informative for young girls in this industry. I mean, your mindset is so big. Like, I don't normally see people with the mindset of your age then in this industry. Because for me, I've never wanted to be, like, a ramp model. Because I just thought it was just too brutal and crucial. So do you ever do public speaking or, like, mentorships or teaching, you know, for models in the future?
Yeah, so it's definitely something that I'm looking into.
Mm-hmm.
Because as I'm, you know, making my way in the industry, and I have, like, you know, experience from 10 years ago to now, that comparison, and then also just because I think, you know, modeling can be a dangerous industry, especially when you're thinking of, like, human trafficking, because there really isn't, it is very so much hearsay, it is very so much, oh, I know that this person is legit because of this connection,
mm-hmm.
or because of other models, like, affirming it,
mm-hmm.
but, like, you have some situations that are legit opportunities, and they're just a person that, you know, no one really knows, and
what are some red flags that we should look for?
So, models, if you are entering into modeling, or we're in the age of influencers as well,
mm-hmm.
if someone's reaching out to you and they say, hello, congratulations, we want to inform you that you have been selected for anything and you haven't applied, it's a scam. If you see anything with grammatical errors, obviously, you know, take that with a grain of salt because we are humans,
mm-hmm.
but, you know, people get paid, like, especially, like, if it's big campaigns, like, Old Navy, Sephora, they have, like, teams that, like, sift through all their messages, and it's copy and paste and customized as well,
mm-hmm.
but, like, there should not be grammatical errors. So if you see anything with grammatical errors, it's not a real opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
What else? I would say, and sometimes opportunities come in, and if someone reaches out to you, they will never say, hey, we have a great opportunity, reach back out if you're interested.
Okay.
No. They'll say, hey, we have this opportunity, here's what this, like, what it is, like, what you'll be doing, how much you'll be paid,
mm-hmm.
What the time is, what they're looking for, all that stuff will be sent to you, and then they'll say, if you're interested in this opportunity, please submit your comp card or please submit information. Those situations tend to be are more accurate,
mm-hmm.
but even in those situations, you still have to do your due diligence. Like, if they ask you, like, what your horoscope is, and I've seen that.
Okay.
We're like, what's your horoscope? But I'm like, all right, you said that's a thing that's like in society nowadays, but, like, no professional person is going to put that when they're, like, asking for information about you,
mm-hmm.
then I'm going to be like, what's your horoscope? We just want to see that, like, our whole team matches. They're trying to make money. You're trying to make money. Like, no.
So let me ask you this. Would you say that, like, so I know for acting, if anyone comes and says, oh, you got to take all these acting classes and we'll do all these headshots for you, that's a red flag.
Mm-hmm.
No. So what are the red flags when you're going to a school or finding an agent to get into modeling? To discern, like, they're not just trying to take your money.
Mm-hmm.
What should, you know, future models be looking for?
Yeah, for sure. So, in the modeling industry, because everyone, you know, everyone wants to be a model. And
mm-hmm.
I think that was awesome. I think that, you know, the industry has a really awesome place to
mm-hmm.
to really use that to cast people who look like the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
But with that being said, because of that, some people prey on that. They're like, all right, you're hungry, you're going to want these things, but I promise you these big gigs with these industry or like certain industry leaders, whatever. But I say, but we need to develop you a little bit more.
Mm.
Now, there obviously there are nuances to this, right?
Right.
But for the most part, if you are a new model and you go into a legit agency and you don't have a portfolio and they're saying, hey, you need to build a portfolio, then definitely, yes. Like, you can't enter into an agency and say, like, I want to get booked and then don't have photos to show the people who are going to be booking you.
Would you go through the agencies for their photographer, or can you use your own?
So that's the catch there, right?
Okay.
Sometimes they'll say, oh, we have our, like, in-house photographers,
yeah,
and pay them X amount of money to get photos.
Right. Thousands of dollars.
Sometimes. And sometimes it's just, like, a steep, like 300, 500,
yeah,
you know, and, like, when you're entering into the industry, like, and you're, like, the humble beginnings, like, that's a lot of money.
That is a lot of money.
Some places will say, like, we want our photographers because we know they have great work,
mm-hmm,
and that's valid.
Okay.
But I would like to put out there that my portfolio was built from connecting with people and networking.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time, it was trade for print, which is I'll do a photo shoot with you for free. We both get the photos for your portfolio and for mine.
Nice.
And that, mm-hmm, right? Now, I understand that we're in a smaller market where that's a lot easier to do.
Yeah.
Now, if you're in New York, places like that, like,
yeah,
you might have to pay money, and that's okay, but, like, I think looking at their work,
mm-hmm,
and you can see that by their website, their Instagram page, like, is it quality work? And if it is, then pay them, right? Because you're trying to get paid too, right?
Yeah.
So support another, you know, creative,
yeah,
graphic in their industry.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you do have predatory, like, agencies that are, how is it, aren't real?
There's a lot of them out there.
There's a lot.
And you just have to be discerning, do a little bit of investigation,
yeah,
you know, ask around, because it can get really scary.
Yeah.
But I want to go into your business, and the whole purpose of you coming onto this story is because we talked about the fashion industry, and now it's killing the planet. And, you know, I was doing a little research about how all of these cheap websites like Shein, Fashion Nova, and how they're putting lead and poison in the clothing, and you were telling me about the herb and how it's not healing properly, because there's, like, just very minimal resources and materials that are all natural. Can you, like, elaborate on that? Let's talk about that.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, that was interesting. Yeah, tell me. I was just like, what?
Yeah, so... Yeah.
Did you hear about Shein?
Yeah, it's...
And AliExpress and Zaful and all of these places.
My gosh, don't get me in.
Let's get into it. That's why we're here.
Shein, like, rattles my bones because outside of being, like, a fast fashion brand, so what that means is... everything is produced, like, quickly,
mm-hmm,
for profit.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not produced with quality so that it lasts for you.
Yeah.
And it's using natural... It could be using cotton. And cotton, I forget, like, how much gallons, but it's a lot of gallons of water it takes to grow
cotton.
Mm-hmm. And then to use it and then to not use it all and to throw it away or whatever is
wasteful.
So, and the dyes that they're using, the preservatives that they're using, like, all that's going into the water streams. But Shein, so that's, like, fast fashion is just, it's polluting our earth because a lot of the time it's using things like polyester, nylon, so all these, like, plastic-based, fabrics. So
they're made with plastic?
Yeah.
Oh.
So that means that it's coming from big oil, which is a whole other thing.
You know about that being in sustainable energy.
Yeah, it's coming from big oil, so it's being produced from crude oil,
ooh,
which, you know, like,
oh, okay,
has its own resources. So CO2, all these things,
mm-hmm,
it takes CO2 to create this fabric,
yeah,
but more importantly, this fabric does not break down. So, like, if in most pants, you know, we end up with... Let's be honest, especially if you're a thick girl, you love the stretch. You love the stretch jeans. Like,
yeah.
I'm not saying get rid of it.
Yeah.
I'm just saying be more wise in what you're purchasing and is it quality, right? Because since it is plastic, and if you, especially the chub rub, you know, when you have, like...
Yeah. Because I have big thighs, so yeah. I get it. I totally get it.
Your thighs just eat that. Eat your game. You're just like, well, dang, I can't fix this. So then you toss it, and then it's like, I can't donate it. But if it has this plastic in it, it's not going to break down. It's just going to sit there for years. And if it does break down, now we have the issue with microplastics, which there was just a research, actually, one of my friend's husbands found this in Colorado, was one of the lead people on this, was they found microplastic in rainwater. So what that means is the water that's evaporating, the plastics are so micro that it's literally floating up into a cloud.
Nasty.
And then raining back down. That's how like intense microplastics are, right? And it's a huge issue because it's toxic.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're finding it in fish. Now, like, I'm pretty sure, like, every human probably is walking around with microplastics inside of them. And we're digesting that. So, like, it has a, like, again, like, this full circle impact.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's really important to, you know, go for more natural fabric. So, like, cotton, linen, hemp, wool.
Yes. Oh, hemp. I didn't even know. Yeah, that would be good.
Hemp is, like, is the way of the future, I believe.
Okay.
Like,
and hemp is kind of soft, too.
It is.
It's fresh. It feels fresh and flowy.
Mm-hmm.
So, what is hemp exactly? What is it made out of exactly? I mean,
So, hemp, I mean, I was like, hemp is hemp.
That's what I thought.
It is like they are like cousins.
They're cousins.
Like in terms of like when you're looking
like,
at the species, right?
Okay, so like.
So like they are related, but it does not have any like THC in it.
THC.
So
THC.
So which is the stuff that gets you high, right?
Okay.
So like there's none of that in there.
Okay.
And hemp actually is a great plant because you can utilize every aspect of hemp.
Okay.
Right from the stalk to the seed. I eat hemp seeds. Hemp seeds are like.
You can ingest it too, right?
Yeah, hemp seeds are super like. Nutritional, like
okay.
Like they have all the omega fatty acids. They're high in like phosphorus, high in iron, high in magnesium. So it was like a superfood,
okay.
Right? And then also too, hemp has the ability to purify soil, right? So if something is contaminated, obviously if you're using growing hemp on it to take out the contaminants, you can't utilize any of that. You have to properly dispose of it.
Uh-huh.
But it's like this really awesome plant that actually could. You know, change the game.
So that might be the new material for our clothing wear.
Well, I would say so, but there is this huge misconception with hemp because, like, just like you said, like you're like, oh, I think of, like, you know, marijuana.
Like, well, I know it's in the family, but I know it. Yeah.
But you have people who are like strongly anti-marijuana, right? So then they will never say yes to hemp because they're gonna be like.
So
you have these people who are like strongly like opposed to like marijuana and all aspects.
Yeah.
Hemp is a cousin, but it has no THC, so which is what people are like opposed to marijuana
right.
about. But because they know that it's siblings, they're like, oh, I'm never gonna do that. And whatever you're telling me, it's just you're trying to get me on like this liberal whatever anything. And I'm just like, our founding fathers, for the people who are like super conservative, I'm like, the founding fathers grew hemp. They knew the importance of hemp. They came here with hemp ropes on their ships.
Right.
And
right.
So like, here you go. We're just going backward. You just have to. I feel like when you're in sustainability, you learn that you have to figure out what people's values are and approach sustainability from that place with them.
Okay. And
otherwise.
Yeah, to educate them so they can see beyond the tunnel vision.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a little concerning because, I mean, like for me, I you know, I love a good pair of jeans.
Mm-hmm.
And to get a good, I don't like the stretchy jeans and they make my thighs feel like they're congested. But to find a good pair of jeans like Levi's, they're like $100 because it's like real cotton or jeans or whatever jeans are made of. Why is it so expensive to buy cotton? I mean, weren't you telling me something about how the earth takes a long time to rehabilitate after growing? Let's talk about that.
Yeah, so that's really important because obviously, you know, as I'm advocating for more sustainable practices in the fashion and people buying sustainable fashion, the first thing you're going to notice is the price point. That's it. You're going to be like, well, that I could just buy a shirt for $5 versus buying a shirt for $45,
right,
$60, $80.
Mm-mm.
And it's like, that hits my pocket. Sabbath is a huge thing, right? Like resting, the day of rest. God rested when he created everything.
Right.
Right? And he tells us to rest as well and to honor the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
But it goes beyond that. Even when you're growing food in that time, on the seventh year, you would let that plot of land sit.
Okay.
And then you move to another plot of land.
Okay.
Right? And
yeah.
So here you see like this regenerative practice
mm-hmm.
in the Bible that like goes back to the immolating God,
yeah.
right? And honoring
right.
God in
right.
the land.
And
right?
we're not honoring the land.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. We are stewards of this earth, and I think that has been misused
mm-hmm.
by Christians of like, oh, I can do whatever I want because I have authority over it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But it's just like, but think about it this way. Does God say that to you?
Exactly.
No. He didn't say I can do whatever I want because I own this, because
mm-hmm.
I created this.
Right.
He says he still gives you free will,
right.
and he still approaches you in honor, love, care,
mm-hmm.
right? So when we say that we're stewards of the earth, we should be emulating what that looks like with God, right? So if God is kind, loving, just for our good,
mm-hmm.
stewards of the earth should be, we're kind, loving, just of the earth,
mm-hmm.
and for its good. Which ultimately will be for our good as well, because it's sustaining us. We live here.
Right.
And this goes to crap. There is no, like, other option. Like, we're just gonna, like, die of suffocation, die of toxic poison
yeah.
from our water, die
mm-hmm.
from whatever. And it's like, we don't have to live that way.
So, are they increasing the price of cotton because they're producing so much, and they are honoring the earth and letting, you know, those plots heal,
mm-hmm.
or and so it's less cotton that they can grow? Or are they producing cotton and charging a lot because it takes a lot to make a pair of pants?
Yeah, so it just depends on like which brand you're like going after. So
mm-hmm.
For the most part, it's literally just the resources that's used
yeah.
to grow the cotton and to have everything be 100% cotton. So you're not using more cotton if you're not cutting it, right?
Okay.
So there is a cost associated with it.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I say to this for people who are like, man, this price point, but I understand that like fast fashion is harming the earth, and ultimately it's going to affect black and brown communities first. And
oh, yeah.
I'm like seeing
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to, but I like, this is expensive. Think of it this way. Fast fashion, most of the time, like, it rips within like a year,
oh,
2 years.
No, let's try washing it, and it's done.
Yeah.
I mean, and I can go to a boutique where someone who, you know, was into fashion would buy a pair of jeans that I would buy in the store for $100 for like 30.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very good quality jeans, like the Gap,
yeah.
you know, like Levi, and that's what I do. But as far as sustainability, what do you think is the state of the fashion industry right now when it comes to clothing? Because right now, like, there's a Family Dollar right up the street, and they sell clothing. And I found out now they're putting toxic chemicals in those clothings, in the clothings, and they're causing damaging effects to the brain, the heart, the kidneys, and the reproduction systems.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, cheap things. Would you consider like Walmart one of those places, or would Walmart be? I don't know. I mean, like I just, you know, Target.
I feel like I'm whoever's going to be watching this is going to be ripping your heart to shreds.
Because I mean, I don't buy certain, like, Walmart is certain things I buy, like, household goods.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, like, they're putting Family Dollars and little things like this in our neighborhoods, and, you know, so you can buy cheap toys, you can buy, and there's lead, there's so many chemicals in all these items,
mm-hmm.
and because of the cost, we can't afford it. Whereas for me, I would rather just pay for a more expensive, more quality pair of jeans or a shirt for my child than to get something cheap because, you know, I can't afford it. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, so it's really complex, right? Because I think we hear things like that with, like, Family Dollar, and we're like, oh, Family Dollar, so I just won't go there.
Yeah.
I'll, like, go to Walmart.
Yeah.
But Walmart's in the same boat.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'll go to Target. Target's in the same boat.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'll go to Gap. Gap's in the same boat.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'll go to Levi. Levi's in the same boat.
Okay.
You know, so it's just like, yes, is it different tiers to it?
Yeah.
Right? Because with Levi's, you know, they are, sometimes they have 100% cotton. But you'll actually, if you look at the label, like, you'll see that they're not doing that anymore.
Yeah.
So, with all that being said, most clothing have some type
some sustainable brands?
That's a great question. Let's see if I can think of some in my mind.
One or two.
Yeah, I'm like, ooh, I gotta think about this actually. Because, like, for me, because sustainable fashion can be expensive, mm-hmm. I tend to do more thrifting.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
It's like keeping things out of the landfill. Mm-hmm. these boots, not for me, but I love them.
We'll definitely come back to that question because I do want to lead in about your business.
Yeah, but I do want to answer the question.
Oh, okay, cool.
Some options,
okay.
Right?
What are some options?
So some options for sustainable practices, I would say would be, I'm having a brain fart. Maybe we'll come back to this.
It's okay. So we talked about this a year ago about your business. So mm-hmm. It's online.
Yeah.
And it's the revivalapparellllc.com?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it the model? Okay, that's your modeling page. Okay. So I went on there. Mm-hmm. Did you create these designs?
Yeah, so right now.
Beautiful.
So right now I'm in phase one of the business, which
okay.
is reselling thrifted items that I find.
Okay.
To give people a more affordable option.
But with more quality and sustainability.
Exactly.
Okay.
So these things have been pre-loved before,
mm-hmm.
hence the name Revival, right? So that name's very intentional, has roots with my faith, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it also has roots with reviving old clothing and giving new life.
Yeah.
And then, so phase one of the business is to resell thrifted fashion,
yes.
or upcycle some thrifted things that I find.
Mm-hmm.
And then phase two, which we have not entered into yet, but I'm excited, I'm working
okay.
on things,
mm-hmm.
Is the slow fashion part of it, right? So I'm going to create patterns, fabric, designs, dresses, pants,
mm-hmm.
Suits, all these things on my body,
okay.
right, to show it. And if someone likes it, then they can choose like what fabric they want,
mm-hmm.
the color. I will take their like custom measurements.
So you're going to sew them?
Yes.
Oh, you are the bomb!
Yeah, and
okay.
the reason why that is because like I started Revival because I wanted a sustainable option, because
mm-hmm.
but I also realized that there was a lack of plus sizing sustainable options.
Okay.
And if brands did have plus sizing that was sustainable,
mm-hmm.
that was the first thing to go,
mm-hmm.
and it almost seemed like there was never a restock.
Yeah.
For many reasons like we mentioned before,
gotcha.
If you're plus size, it takes you more fabric, so it's kind of more expensive.
Mm-hmm.
All of things. So I was just like, all right, well, I'm passionate about sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
There is almost none, like no like plus size sustainable fashion
mm-hmm.
lines that I could actually utilize as a platform for myself
right.
to be that emblem and to continue pushing the mold for sustainable practices in
mm-hmm.
fashion. So I was just like, well, then I'm going to create it because, you know, plus size people deserve this. Like, we deserve to be fashionable, to look great, to
right.
move in confidence and
mm-hmm.
not feel constantly have to deal with people being threatened by our bodies, by our existence.
Or just that the only thing you can put me in is a muumuu and some leggings. Like,
yeah,
I need to wear
like,
something that makes me feel good.
These weird Elmo faces,
yeah, some
things.
Just unacceptable.
Or then, or hypersexualized, where like you're just showing all the skin, and I'm like, you know, do you boo boo? But like for me, I'm just like, I want to embody elegance. I want to embody grace.
Yeah.
I don't know, I do want to be a little spicy sometimes. So like Revival is inspired by me.
Mm-hmm.
It is a love letter to Black women particularly, but people of color
mm-hmm.
as well. And it's because fast fashion does target our people.
Yeah.
Fashion Nova being one of them.
Yeah. Because it's cheap. But
it's cheap.
Those fashions, whatever you see last year, it's gone.
Yeah.
So I have a question when you said Revival, because you do like an upgrade on them. Do you like redesign them
mm-hmm.
when you buy these and then put them on the website? Do
so
you add
it depends.
Some, okay.
It depends. Yeah.
Sorry.
So some things are just
mm-hmm.
fine as it is. Like, it's a great find,
mm-hmm.
and I'm just like, someone deserves this. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
And some things that, need a little loving, need a little updating in terms of style.
Yeah.
So I'll update them.
Nice.
And eventually there. And speaking of that too, I want to get into that because you brought up Cheyenne, and another thing that Cheyenne does,
yes,
for people who are like, I'm gonna keep shopping. Please don't. She instills the designs of small business owners, especially black and brown business owners, replicate them and then sell them, and no one's holding them accountable. Many people have been victims of that, and they've made millions of dollars off of them, and they will never see a profit of it because they're actively targeting small businesses because they know they'll never be able to touch them legally.
That is so true. I want to say about a couple of years back, there was this blogger, he was a YouTube influencer, and I followed him for a long time until he left YouTube and went on his own platform. And I believe his name was Everybody Hates Angel, but he used to sell t-shirts, custom-made t-shirts, and he found out that they were being sold mimic in China on some type of website. But he ended up using his lawyer to make them cease and desist. But they do. That just goes to show us as people of color how creative we are and how much of a contribution we are to this industry on every level of entertainment, because they need us to survive, you know. So thank you for that. That is important, because after I learned about it having lead and toxins, like, I'll never order there, never. But as you say, it's not 100% across the board to find anything unless it's completely sustainable.
Yeah. You always find some traces, but again,
But if it's more good than bad, it's like,
yeah,
it's like, we'll do CBD. Anyway,
we're just like, I'll take some of it.
Participants are laughing. Hey, you know what? When I went through your website, because I did, it was so beautiful. I love the little the quotes you had. Give light, and people will find their way. Ella Baker. A wise girl knows her limits. A smart girl knows that she has them. Clothes mean nothing until someone finds it. Styles it and loves it. From there, clothes morph into attitude, personality, and vision. Who said that? Was that you? I like that one. That was my favorite. Where flowers bloom, so does hope. Trends fade, however true fashion is timeless. So this was something that I thought was very interesting. She says, did you know the fashion industry is the second most pollutant industry outside of oil and coal? Crazy, right? Yeah. You're doing great things. So tell everybody, where's your social media handles?
For my modeling page, please do follow me. I'm trying to get better at taking you guys along with the journey of what the industry is like from the inside. So that is Miss_Chelsea_Cheyenne. That is my Instagram handle. That's where you'll find everything.
Okay.
And for my sustainable fashion line, it is Revival Apparel LLC.
Mm-hmm.
And you can find that on Instagram at _Revival_Apparel.
Are you on Facebook?
We
don't have to get that.
I
a different one.
Yes, I'm on Facebook for Revival Apparel and my modeling line as well. And it kind of just like automatically uploads from Instagram, so you can follow that as well.
Twitter? Any Twitter?
Not on Twitter.
No TikTok?
I'm not on TikTok yet because I'm a huge person of like, I like to be intentional about the types of, I'm not a social media person at all.
I feel you.
The reason why I'm on social media is because you have to be in the industry.
Yeah.
So I'm stretching there. But with TikTok, I would say it's definitely in the future. It has not happened yet, and there's intentional steps for that for me. So.
Okay, so those are all your social media handles. So the last thing I want to say is, what's next for Chelsea? When's your next show? Where are you going? Are you branching off and going to do your own thing? Or are you still kind of doing that exodus plan that we talked about?
So what's next for me? Next show that I have is actually tomorrow in Victor, Colorado.
Okay.
I'll be working with the awesome trajectory.
Okay.
And what they do is they take industry leaders, like, and this is what I love about it. It's like, you know, you can always get a sewing class from anyone who knows how to sew.
Uh-huh.
But like, and don't get me wrong, anyone who can sew, you can learn something.
Right.
But if you really like have this passion to like
create,
mm-hmm. to be the next thing in the fashion industry,
mm-hmm.
at Fashion Factory, they have so many designers who actively have their own lines who have shown in like London Fashion Week, New York Fashion Week. Like, it's a big deal. So you can learn from these people who are in the industry.
Mm-hmm.
So outside of just like learning how to sew, you can actually ask them questions, mentor, all these things. So I'm going to be walking for them, and particularly with a designer who's under them, or not under them, but she helps teach.
Okay.
And the designer is called DRC Studios.
Where is she located?
In Denver, yeah.
Yeah, but where in Denver?
Well, I mean, I feel like her line doesn't necessarily have, like,
okay.
a home job.
Okay, so it's an online line, but she does
yes.
in-house teaching.
Yeah, so she teaches through Fashion Factory, which is,
yeah.
like, what teaches people how to, like, sew and all these things.
Okay.
But she had, like, her line is her own entity.
Okay.
That
gotcha.
She does that. So, like, she teaches for fun, you know, like, she teaches to, like, teach the next generation, but, like, she has her own line that's going.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
All right, so you got a show coming up. Everything's going on. You got your business. You didn't answer the question.
Oh, so, I mean, obviously, I think for me, I am in this place where I'm still filling things out. You know,
okay.
I'm still...
Mm-hmm.
and modeling can kind of sustain,
mm-hmm.
Because I do want to move into more, like, not necessarily mentorship things,
mm-hmm.
but, like, I do want to, involve myself more
mm-hmm.
into the fashion industry, especially, like, with the coordinating of it,
mm-hmm.
and also helping other models along the way,
yeah,
especially young, because the industry
mm-hmm.
is so young.
Yeah.
I'm 26 as of today. I feel like when in the industry wins for modeling, that's old.
Is that old?
It's very old.
I thought that stuff was gone because now they have mature models. And
they do, but
everything.
Like it's still not broken down like as much
mm-hmm.
as like the mature models. I guess it's kind of right. But with the mature models, they typically have something that sticks out. That
mm-hmm.
like so like they have like really really like pretty gray hair.
Right.
So like there's
something
like,
distinct.
Something distinct
mm-hmm.
that makes it. We're like, okay, we can, like, capitalize on this type
okay,
of thing.
Gotcha.
But, yeah, so I think that's probably going to be my next step is maybe, like, helping mentor another generation.
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, human trafficking is a huge thing,
mm-hmm.
and Denver is a big place for that. Is this person safe? Like, is this okay?
Yeah.
Starting that up to like have some type of vetting system to keep people safe because there's too many people go missing in a year.
Oh, I know. The trafficking is, yeah, it's horrible. I went down a rabbit hole looking at YouTube videos about that, and they start off talking about how you know they could be a model and in the mall, and you know, do people even go to the mall anymore?
Yeah, but it is a real
yeah.
thing, and there's something else. So be safe out there, ladies.
Yeah.
Yes, you know, if you have hunger, you have drive, go for it.
Yeah.
But don't make reckless decisions. Make sure someone always knows where you are at all times. And be safe. If you have a red flag going off, no gig is worth your safety.
Yeah.
It's just not.
Thank you. Thank you, Chelsea, for coming
yeah.
on. You've given us so much words of wisdom, some pearls of wisdom. You've given me so much information, things I didn't even know about. And we can find you on where again? Let's talk about that. What's your website?
Yes. So my website is www.modelchelseacheyenne.com. You can find me there. Or you can find me on Instagram, which is miss_chelsea_cheyenne.
And your apparel?
And my fashion line, you can find the website for that is www.revival.com.
Mm-hmm.
That's important. LLC.
LLC.
far as sustainability. In the meantime, thank you for joining me, Marios.